Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, the Collegiate Star League, League of Legends 2016 Spring Playoffs. My name is Reed Rapid Melton. Joining me tonight, as always, is Joshua Feke's Quest. After the entire season, you think I'd get tired of saying that every time, but I can never get tired of you, Feke's. And of course, our wonderful viewers as well. So, big fans of you all, and also love myself some League of Legends. Let's get into it. Between Robert Morris University and Carleton. Carleton, first two letters are also the country name of their school. So, pretty big fan of them. Let's go ahead and hop in to Picks and Bans. RMU on the blue side on the left-hand side of your screen versus Carleton, who are coming out in the red on the right. And also, Feke's, somewhere out there, I'm positive, I know it's going to happen. But we'll try to get young Feke's in here as soon as possible. And hope.
Can you hear me?
There we go.
Oh, okay. I don't know what happened. My mic said it was on. I'm sorry about that. I was rambling. I was wondering. I was like, why is he interrupting me?
I'm just a jerk, man. I'm like the worst co-caster.
It hasn't been that long. Come on. I was mentioning though, Robert Morris University. They're actually coming into this one undefeated. They went 6-0 in the fall, and they are 7-0 now. They did have a first round bye in this the spring playoffs for CSL. So. They don't have as much practice as Carleton. They actually 2-0'd both of their playoffs against Indiana and Cornell so far. So they got a little bit of experience in the playoffs already under the belt, a little bit more than Robert Morris. But they did drop two games back in the fall. So they don't have a perfect record, but their spring record so far, and that's when the shakeup happened with the divisions and turned into groups, they are 6-0 right now. So we'll see what they can do against Robert Morris and, of course, vice versa. Speaking of Robert Morris, the Gragas locked in, becoming more of a popular pick these days.
Right, and not only is it more of a popular pick, it's also, I'd say, top three junglers out there right now. Depends on your level of acuity with your junglers. If you're god on things like Nidalee or Lee Sin, you can definitely make your mark known no matter where those champions fall on the tier list. But already locking in some jungle picks there. And also with the Shyvana, locked in so early, it's a little bit interesting to me. She's kind of a tank buster. She does percentage max health magic damage, so it's like, you kind of want to run her if you're planning an aggressive strategy. And the reason you'd pick Shyvana, usually you go with Nidalee, but that's been banned. So it's interesting. Haven't seen a Shyvana competitively in a very long time, back from the days where she used to be even a top laner. So nice to see her back on the Rift. Yeah. And, might have some big hard engage from Carleton coming in with a lock-in on Malphite and Ashe. This is all – you can start to already see kind of what the idea that they're starting to get here.
Yeah, big front line coming out from Carleton. Of course, that does mean that the ADC of Carleton will also be super immobile. But yeah, huge engage coming out from them. And we'll see how they make that one work. Now on the other side, RMU, yeah, you do have the Gragas explosive cast to really break up that engagement, maybe even disengage. Pillar of Filth can be both really, really good, especially against an Ashe who doesn't have a gap closer. You have to walk straight through the Pillar of Filth. Actually, I think it's Pillar of Ice now. But you have to walk right through his big slow zone from the pillar. Makes it very hard for an Ashe to get away. We'll see how they react on that one in Carleton.
Yeah, that's actually just going to be really difficult because Ashe is going to be trying to stand in the back. Trundle just walks up, throws a pillar on her, and there's not a whole lot she can do other than flash away from it or walk very slowly away. And we might see Swiftness Boots Ashe here as a way to get around that. But whoa, that's a Vel'Koz. And so you see the Gangplank ban. That's equally targeted. But the Vel'Koz pick, you don't have players who are just like, okay, well, I played a few games with Vel'Koz, let me just bust him out. You got to be really good with that guy. So that's scoutable, and we'll see whether or not it is something that maybe should have hit the ban list. But and there's a Yasuo as well. So.
Oh my gosh.
Lifeform Disintegration Rays, you know what the number one counter to those are?
What's that?
Wind. Literally just the air, Feke's, completely counters champions. And so not sure about the Vel'Koz pick into the Yasuo, it was actually Yasuo picked afterwards. Right. So is that the counter they need? Who knows?
We'll see here. Now, this is what I really like about Collegiate games. You have niche picks. We have a Shyvana on one team. We have a Vel'Koz on the other team. You won't see this in the LCS, and that's why I really love Collegiate games. They play at a high mechanical caliber, but they're not afraid to bring out these niche picks. It's like, hey, guys, I'm really comfortable on this champion, Vel'Koz, but he's super immobile, guys. Yeah, but I'm really comfortable on him. All right, go and play him. And that's why we are seeing a Vel'Koz right now. don't know where he fits in here. He's immobile. They have a huge engage over on Carlton. It would take one push of the R button from Oh Mother Hen to just get into the back lines and knock up the big tentacle monster. But we'll see how RMU decides to play that one off.
Yeah, I feel like Mother Hens should probably be a little bit more caring, but unfortunately this one has murderous intent.
He's caring for his team.
I just got my my chicken coop in Stardew Valley, man. I've been making lots of mother hens, but this one looks totally different than all of those. So be excited to see whether or not this hard engage from Carlton makes it work, or whether or not we get some life form disintegration going on from Nubsy. Either way, let's go ahead and get into a short commercial break. Got to mention our sponsors before we head into that, though. Got to give a big thanks to Twitch TV for sponsoring the CSL and featuring our weekly matches. In fact, if you guys are watching from the front page of Twitch, big fans, come on over. Love to hear what you guys have to say. Definitely proud to be affiliated with the largest gaming stream provider in the world, Fekez.
Yeah, me too. And I'm also very excited to be affiliated with Asus ROG, Asus Rogue, Republic of Gaming, gamers. That is why we're going to DreamHack, why we're able to fund this this playoff tournament to DreamHack, where the top four teams from CSL will play on the grand stage live in front of an audience at DreamHack. It's going to be very exciting. We have Asus Rogue to thank for that one because they are the ones funding it with fantastic PCs, laptops, and monitors. Go check them out on Twitter at Asus_ROG. They're very awesome. Give them a shout out and tell them thank you for sponsoring the CSL.
And last but not least, got to give a shout out to Brain Gear. If you guys want to get your brain into gear, then definitely check them out. It's a scientifically developed 2-ounce formula that provides you the focus and clarity you need to get the long-term brain health benefits you feel good about. It's got things like vitamin B12, B6, green tea extract, vitamin E, vitamin D. It's personally my favorite vitamin, and I know you guys love a lot of those out there too. So definitely support Brain Gear and thank them for supporting us. And last but not least, big thanks to everyone out there watching in chat. Love to have you out here for tonight's matches as we enter the round of 32 with RMU versus Carlton. We'll give you guys more of a breakdown of the teams when we get into game. But in the meantime, stick around. We'll be right back after a short commercial break, so don't go anywhere. And welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. We could be legends, and so can these guys. Thanks for tuning in to the round of 32. Yeah, getting these CSL playoffs underway. Hope you guys are ready for some League of Legends action. And maybe we should give a little bit of background about these two teams. RMU, if you pay attention to collegiate esports, you don't even have to think twice about this team. They've been around in collegiate esports, have one of the best collegiate esports programs in North America, and they are a titan in the CSL. Undefeated, like you mentioned, Fekez, and right after their post-NACC roster swap. They are looking even, you know, even stronger every time I got a chance to watch one of their scrims or games a couple weeks ago. And yeah, gotta say, a little bit favored here coming in for me, but Carlton hasn't really run up against any roadblocks lately either. So not really sure how these teams will face off against each other, which is why we're playing this game here today.
And that's why they both are in the round of 32. So only one of them can go on. This is a kind of a do or die moment. It is a best of three. So they both have to win, you know, two games to go by and advance to the round of 16. I believe that's how it goes. Yeah, math is accurate there. But yeah, this is it. Looks like we have a little bit of a shenanigans coming out in the top lane.
Yeah, a little bit late there on that invade. You really have to get your early invades down pretty impeccably. And immediately, great reaction here by Carlton. What they're going to do is say, hey, you know, we know that, actually, Braum's still going to go in for the invade. That's actually really smart. Yes, not going to try for the steal, but just being annoying.
Yeah, just being annoying. I mean, he's not really doing too much right now, but he is giving Mikey Moss solo XP, so he will be able to level up to his level 6 a little bit faster. That's about all he can do, I guess, but in the meantime, in the mid lane, a little bit of damage going on to Musical Notes here, trying to trade back onto Nubsies, lands the tornado, knocks him up. That's about it, but he loses his overall health and some actual wave on that, getting pushed to turret, afraid to go up to CS against Nubsy, afraid to get hit with a Tectonic Disruption, or any others that, I guess actually it's level 2, it is a doesn't even have Tectonic Disruption. Does have Void Rift and the Plasma Fission, so just afraid to CS underneath this turret right now. That's actually one of the biggest disadvantages for Musical Notes when he doesn't have Windwall.
Right, and that mid lane matchup can definitely go either way, depending on who plays more confidently and aggressively. For Vel'Koz, you have to know that you're going to land all of your damage, and for Musical Notes, you really have to... Oh, nice Windwall!
Nice.
See exactly what you're looking for to win that lane is Yasuo.
Yeah, and that knockup is what really sets up all the combos for Vel'Koz. So blocking that is essentially blocking a huge portion of his damage. But we do have tower pushing coming out from both sides. It looks like Robert Morris University is going to knock down the turret first. And no surprise, a Lucian does, you know, take down a turret a little bit faster than an Ashe, but they'll both go down almost at the same time.
All right, as I go ahead and put everybody where they are supposed to be on the champion overlay, you can see a little bit of counter jungling there, and with the first two turrets of game going down, that does mean that we're shaping up for, you know, a little bit of a faster lane phase. So we're already going to say, okay, took down our first turrets, going to get the first recalls from the duo lanes in, and probably swap those around to the opposite sides of the map to try to look to push down more early turrets.
Jezzy finishing up, actually that's a steal of the red buff away from Robert Morris University, so gonna be taking that one away from freaking Pope. I don't think he's gonna be too phased by it though, with these lane swaps. It's really lane swaps make everything a little bit sketchy. Some people kind of, there's been controversy with them, some people say it's boring, but it's also very strategic, the lane swaps. You have to play it exactly right, and also just kind of do what you can to the enemy as well. It's very technical. I don't think people appreciate that near enough. Another great Windwall, by the way, from Musical Notes, blocking a lot of damage from Nubsy.
All right, we got some supportal combat in here. Forcing
Flash.
The Flash out. Yeah, freaking Pope right where he needed to be. He said, hey, I got my red buff stolen. I need to make up for that. So he's able to walk into the enemy jungle, look for that steal. Didn't find the steal, but was still able to get that Flash out. So still getting a little bit of value, even if he didn't get a red buff.
And yeah, it looks like Ecstasy, well, I guess the bot lane of Carlton actually staying bot lane, not going to, actually just going to defend their own turret here. Banana Warrior. Yeah.
A couple of interesting things that we're seeing here. Saw Shyvana go for a first item recurve bow. A little bit questionable just because if you upgrade your Hunter's Machete into like the first tier of jungle items, you get bonus, like additional bonus gold for every jungle camp that you clear. So going for all this counter jungling, you'd be getting a lot more gold from just killing more jungle camps. However, there's nothing you can say bad about combat stats, and that's exactly what recurve bow gives you. Gonna see. Missed position on that headbutt.
And not exactly what we want from Banana Warrior. There is a possible dive coming in here. Freaking Pope gonna be over the pink ward. He's not level 6, so he's not going to be able to.
They should just start all inning him in the Tribrush, because there's still a minion wave there, and it's not hitting turret yet. So you just go in on that Gragas and force him away. But as is, it will force this teleport out, and that is going to stop this turret from getting pressured. Although now we have the counter teleport from Trundle. He's like, hey man, you just left top lane. I'm going back up there.
Yeah, I mean, that's really, really well played by Turb. Oh, Mother Hen's actually not doing near as well as Turb. He's getting out CS'd pretty heavily right now. And now he's down a turret, or down a teleport without pressuring anything. All he did was help and then just waste his turret. And that actually brings Jezzy to the top lane. So the entirety of Robert Morris University knows where the jungler for Carlton is. And that means they can apply pressure without any consequence right now.
Yeah, but Turb's turret is actually completely safe because he's pushing away from there. I'm just going to call them Turbits for the rest of the day. He's protecting them. And got some additional action going in there as Synoptic is able to block out that Alistar engage. You never really want to engage onto the support unless you got a team to back you up, because that means you're not engaging on their damage, and Ashe versus Lucian early game is not a fight Ashe wants to pick. Especially since she's not level 6 either.
And she also has no mana right now either. So if she hits level 6, she has maybe time for enough mana for one ult, which, you know, is pretty good, but you always want to follow it up with some volleys or anything else that you have in your repertoire. But Ecstasy needs to be careful, just CSing as much as he can right now. Actually, might be getting caught into a pinch, may have to blow a flash here. It actually does. Pillar Filth goes up, knocks him over with the flash. Banana Warrior, no flash on him, actually in a bad position, no level 6 either. First Blood going over to Mikey Moss.
Wow, and just lack of vision in the river. Tried to walk up instead and wound up having to use that AD carry flash, which is really valuable on Ashe just because she is so immobile. And previously she was she still is actually doesn't have level 6, about halfway there. And so without the support, with that engage bottom lane paying off so well, that's going to give the first dragon away at 8 minutes over to RMU.
Yeah, it's a very well played. Yeah, like you said, great vision establishment from RMU. And that was actually huge for both of them, because now you have Ecstasy, immobile ADC, no flash. And that might cost her
baby.
Right here. Oh, but the Q from Synodic and those minions.
Good guy minions, man. Putting in some work. However, speaking of putting in some work, man, Shyvana has been clocking in for a 10-hour shift, Jezzy is on top of that CS. Already is getting benefit from killing those towards her Devourer enchant she's already got on her Skirmisher's Saber. So she is going to be getting... You see all those words? That just means it does a lot of stuff. Well, not necessarily big words, just like lots of them. I'm not going to read that. We all know what Devourer does. You stack it up by killing monsters, you get some bonus power. So excited to see the sort of power farm mentality. And it's easy to learn, but it's hard to go, in on Turb.
Yeah, Unstoppable Force on a Turb. He's not level 6. He blows a flash, and there's Jezzy flying in a dragon form, picking up the kill underneath the turret. So Turb going down. He doesn't have teleport either, so going to be a long way back into that top lane.
And probably a Rift Herald here, just because Shyvana does it so, so quickly. Every time a jungler tells me, you know, hey, I bought Devourer, I need to farm up my Devourer. I'm just like, dude, champion kills count for stacks too. You don't have to farm. Yeah, you can go in for those ganks. And that's exactly what Jezzy was doing, making it pay off up in the top lane. Not only going to get the stack off of the champion kill, but also going to get the stack off of the Rift Herald. Now, I believe there is a bug with Rift Herald where if you only get an assist on the Rift Herald, then you get 5 stacks for it, but if you kill it, you only get 2. However, I don't think that that's actually what happened. I was counting the stacks on his Devourer and has 8 stacks, so did not get 5 from that one. Definitely a lot of stacks to be getting there.
Right.
And already with 5, or with 8 rather, that's actually a lot of stacks to have by 10 minutes in. That means we're looking at a 16 to 17 minute Devourer completion time if this current rate continues. So this is going to be a very scary Shyvana.
He's clearing extremely fast. Like you said, kind of clocking an overtime there. So not shying away from either ganking or staying in his own jungle to stack up that Devourer, because you know once he gets that Devourer, it's going to be huge. But
oh my gosh.
Dashing away from the Tectonic Disruption, very nicely played by Musical Notes. That was a ultimate down from Freakin' Poke to try to set up the kill for Nubsy. But Musical Notes dashing in and out, doing a good job dodging everything. He kept his flash as well, so very nicely played by Musical Notes.
But man, we got to talk about some of the lanes that are actually going pretty well for RMU. They had a good overall strategy. They executed their lane swap very well, but they also have started to maybe fall behind a little bit. That death earlier for Turb is going to keep him from going turbo mode for a little bit longer. Although he does have a champion 1v1 advantage over Malphite, so I don't think he'll be too afraid to stay in lane. Look at that Shyvana damage. Holy cow.
Yeah, you do not want to dual AO a Shyvana right now, especially one with Rift Herald. She does have the Rift Herald buff on her right now, so giving her a little bit of extra stats. Turb, he's in the top lane. He's just trying to do what he can. He's actually two levels under Oh Mother Hin, which is a little bit surprising to me, considering he's had the CS advantage this entire time. But it's not really helping him out so far. He just hit a level 7, so still an entire level down from Oh Mother Hin. See how much that makes a difference. Actually, Oh Mother Hin's able to dual Turb now. Very, a little bit of a turn of a play in the top lane now.
Yeah, but of course, you've got Malphite building defensive stats where Trundle is building offensive stats. And that's one of the things that Trundle can do that not a lot of tanks can do anymore. It used to be that, you know, you build offense early and then transition into tank late because you were fighting 1v1 early and then you'd be fighting 1v5 later on in team fights. But Trundle can actually build a lot of offenses early just because his Subjugate ultimate steals the tanky stats from other laners. And so that's what's going to be really cool, because Malphite's going to be this big tanky tank and Trundle just says, hey, thanks for the stats. Stats man steals them all away later on. So that's a really good matchup, very well thought out by RMU's drafting. But the problem that they're going to run into is going to be this Shyvana in the jungle. It's the most experienced, second most experienced in the game next to Nubzi's Vel'Koz, and it's just going to be ridiculous. Look at the CS difference from the junglers. That's just not even a contest. Whoa, big bass! Yeah.
Flash body slam onto Ecstasy, but Ecstasy had the flash up from before. There's a big unstoppable force after the teleport from Oh Mother Hin. Mikey Moss may be in trouble, but now Nubzi in the bot lane too. Everyone forgot he had teleport, but he did not. Banana Warrior, he may go down, actually gets away, but the life form disintegration ray able to take down Ecstasy. Nubzi picking up that kill. Turb in the bot lane, taking out Oh Mother Hin underneath the turret. And now Banana Warrior, who's going to pick up this kill? It is going to be freaking Pope. Very
bananas.
Nicely played.
What will they do without their warrior now? Who's going to fight off the plagues of, I don't know, bugs or whatever bananas need warriors for? I don't know, but
I have no idea, bro.
Yeah, and right when I was talking about how big the Shyvana is, Shyvana's still big, but unfortunately not involved in that fight. She's top lane. She's pushing. And while, yes, that's very valuable. Oh, man, the knockup. There we go. Going in the last
nice.
Breath.
Musical notes, he's not going to give up. He's going to try to salvage something for his team. Does pick up a kill in the mid lane. Actually has red buff now. That's pretty huge for a Yasuo if he can stick onto you. Nubzi doesn't have his lifeform disintegration ray up, but he has a lot of damage still. Keeping musical notes at bay. Meanwhile, Jezzy, you know, for his contribution here, he was able to take out a turret in the top lane, so did give some gold over to his team.
Right, and so if you just look at the straight-up stats for Shyvana right now, she's cresting the most CS in the game. She's able to kill these off. Yeah,
that jungler.
Yeah, for a brief second, or the most CS on her team. Now, of course, on the other side, that's another thing to talk about, is the CS differences we're starting to see come out here. Vel'Koz, 30 CS advantage over her lane opponent, 20 CS advantage down bottom. So, I mean, this is what happens when you invest this many resources, in your jungler. You got to get some value out of that, and they are getting a lot of value. They got I think 5 buffs in the first 5 minutes, and or first 7 minutes once they respawned, and so just really hoping that your lanes can survive long enough while the Shyvana goes on, you know, the tour debuffs.
Yeah, that's a very appropriate term, because she's already at 20 buffs right, or 20 stacks right now.
So. Yeah, this is a 20 stack Shyvana at 15 minutes. And they were thinking about nerfing Devourer so that it takes additional stacks, but you're still able to stack that one up really quickly, especially when you're this strong as Shyvana.
I want to point out that's also after they took away the 5 stacks from the Rift Herald, because
right.
You said you only got 2 earlier. So that's pretty incredible. If it had it given 5 stacks, it probably wouldn't be at that 25 mark. Or the max stacks right now.
Oh, this is going to be really bad for RMU if they start this. And yeah, okay, wisely enough, waiting to pop that barrel, delays it, and doesn't take any Rift Herald damage. Whoa, there's the flash in! Looking for the knockup! They get it! There's the last breath going in!
Big last breath coming in, and a freaking Pope does end up taking out Musical Notes, though, so Last Breath may have been a little ill-advised there.
Oh, yeah, and you can see Turr, but not looking to go in on that. That Shyvana is ridiculously scary. In Dragon Form, you get a bunch of bonus resistances from your Dragon Form passive. But, oh, man, another nice knock-up.
Yeah, that was a huge knock-up. Life Orb Disintegration Ray was not up at the time, or else XC would have been disintegrated. But this tower is going to go down in favor of Robert Morris University. So that is the third tower of the game for them. They are trailing this, leading this game, I should say, by a little under 3K, about 2.5K right now. Let's see where they go next. Mikey Moss, not going to be caught out. Going to dash over the wall. And Dragon is up. It looks like Robert Morris may want to start this one up.
And Dragon is a big deal for the Dragon. For Shyvana, it represents 5 stacks and an almost sated Devourer just off of that. As Shyvana dives in, gets that Smite Steal, that's how you make it happen. Oh, I believe that was actually Blue Buff Stole. No, okay, it was Smote. I saw it like zip across there. I was like, oh, which champion is it going to? But yeah, Jesse does pick that one up, but they lose the Dragon, and that's second Dragon in a row that Carlton has lost this game.
And this goes lit. Wait, hold on, Jesse. He's going to go right on to Nubsy.
Oh,
flashing the Tower Disruption. Very nicely played by Jesse. Is he going to get the kill? He is finally able to take down Nubsy, but used a flash and ultimate to do so.
Well, was forced to do that thanks to, you know, great sort of crisis management there by Nubsy. If he had landed that Tectonic Disruption, would have been able to escape. So, but you can see how hard Jesse has to work to try to just, like, literally claw his way back into this game for his team. They don't have any dragons. They're down a turret. And he's really the only major threat. You saw, if you watch these team fights, Ecstasy is not effective. He's got Infinity Edge, so you know the damage is there, but he just can't auto attack at all. So some big question marks there as Synodic.
He has the flash as well. Mikey Moss there to, I guess, protect him. I don't know if you really protect anybody when you're an ADC, but he is providing a little bit of backup. Rift Herald being pinged once again as Carlton. They have been prioritizing this Rift Herald over Dragon so far, and which I don't really understand because, again, Jesse would get more stacks from the Dragon. Stacks is he at right now? I did pick up the Rift Herald. He's at 29 stacks. I think that one actually gave 5. I think you were talking about that that bug. I think that one gave 5 because I think he was only at 24 stacks just a moment ago.
Okay, well, I'm not sure which way that's gonna go, but hey, sated is sated, and we're 18 minutes in. This Shyvana is gonna deal like metric tons of damage. And
Titanic Hydro.
In case you guys are wondering, metric tons are actually bigger than regular tons. So that's because you put the E on the end. So, yes. More letters, more weight. Makes it. Whoa, big flash by Turb.
That was a very odd interaction because that was Unstoppable Force being used. And it didn't, I don't know. I think the flash knockup kind of happened simultaneously.
If it happened simultaneously, it probably buffered it. So it was still able to go off immediately afterwards. Either way, Turb with a very nice flash. I'm going to have to go back and watch that in slow motion just to see what happened there. But, man, nice flash away, but still flash is forced out. And just push the pressure on Turb, says, hey, man, you stay up here. You're not doing anything this game. Just chill out for a while. And Jesse, he's been making big plays all game long. He's doubled up his lane opponent's CS, or his jungle opponent's CS. And it's really, you can't say enough for this multi-threat lineup that Carlton are going to be running. You have to protect the carries. Nubsy has already felt the pain of not being peeled for Shyvana dives on her. And the great thing about Lucian is he will be able to kite, but see if he can kite well enough.
And Shyvana is fully stacked now, too. Has the ultimate up right now as well. Has a Titanic Hydra. This would be the time to fight for Carlton right now. Especially if you're Jesse. You have a huge, massive power spike. Huge, massive. That's how big it is. I have to say it twice. The dragon,
both huge and massive simultaneously.
Yeah, they haven't contested a dragon yet, but I think they want to start focusing those. Baron just came up. I don't think they're going to be taking that one for quite a while. But Carlton, they're being a little hesitant right now. Jesse going over to his red buff, going to be taking that one up. And I don't see why not. He's going to be the one in the face of Nubsy, trying to take them down as fast as possible. So both teams just kind of, I guess, taking the easy route here, taking the relaxed and methodical route. Looks like there is a little bit of pressure in the mid lane from Carlton onto the RMU mid lane outer turret, but plenty of wave clear with Nubsy guarding it, especially with blue buff. He's not going to be stopping that wave clear for quite a while.
Still waiting on, yeah, Jesse here.
Yeah,
not very sneaky there. Not the hideout he was looking for. That's like, you know, when you're, you know, you like steal a car and you find this abandoned building, you're like, all right, let's hide out here from the cops. And then you look up and you're like, see this like camera panning over to look at you. You're like, oh man, we picked the wrong house to hide out in, and realize that the jig is in fact up. What the jig is, I'm not sure here, but it was didn't last very long as Jezzy forced into early retirement from his counter jungling career.
Yeah, and again, I want to reiterate, both these teams playing it very slow. I really feel like this is Carlton's chance, because they have a team fighting team, and I don't feel like they're taking advantage of it right now. It's 21 minutes in, all outer turrets are down except for the mid lane from Robert Morris University. We're really waiting for these team fights, and I feel like the trigger is not being pulled. The gun's aimed, it's definitely loaded. You got a loaded Jezzy in there right now. Just don't feel like it's being taken advantage of, Rapid.
It's very rare that you see junglers with double their lane opponent's CS.
I know, he's just a beast right now.
Yeah, same number of kills, so Gragas is keeping up there, but they both fulfill very different roles for their team. For Jezzy, he dives the backline and kills some fools, but for Freakin' Pope, his deal is to use his explosive cask, ideally not to knock Ecstasy into the team. You got Trundle Pillar to make his life miserable. Whew. But you really just need to use your explosive cast to peel Jezzy off the backline. Because if he's ineffective in this fight, if Ecstasy is ineffective, the damage trough is just a little bit too much for Carlton to deal with.
So Turb split pushing the top lane. Dragon is up in 4 seconds, so he has teleport, can teleport down into this one. It looks like Carlton is finally going to contest the Dragon, seeing that there's no more Rift Herald, and it has started immediately. Freakin' Pope. He's actually not in position to contest this, so they're just going to give its dragon up, and that is the first dragon for Carlton University. So they get that little bit of a percentage power spike. Jezzy getting hit up a little bit, and that is a very nice pickup with the boost of swiftness. Very good on Shyvana anyways, but with how many slows that are coming out from RMU, it's that much more important. So I do like that pickup as well. Mikey Moss, see where he goes off to. So I have yet to see a team fight. It's been 2 minutes since I've been complaining about it. I expect to see it sometime. Still not happening though. Turb sticking to his guns in the top lane, just pushing as much as possible. And Jezzy, with this downtime, he's just pushing. He's just not pushing. He's farming. He's just farming jungle all over the place. He has a Hex Shrinker now as well. He's going to go back. I guess he's not going to go back, but he has 1,000 gold in his pocket. Looks like now he's going to go back, see what he buys up, and see what else kind of force he decides to be here.
All right, what kind of force are we looking for? We've already got one unstoppable one.
Oh, Dirk.
Yeah, he's going to get his Dirk.
That's terrible.
Yeah, not all Dirks created equal. For instance, my Dirk probably like way bigger than Feke's Dirk.
Are we really?
I'm just saying, man.
I don't think you want to compare my Dirk to your Dirk.
Oh, man, dude. You're such a Dirk, man.
You're a Dirk. You're a Dirk herder.
All right, well, back to League of Legends. And, farming in the mid lane. Woo! All right, yeah, and to be fair,
this is what we've been seeing for 20 minutes.
Yeah, I was going to say, I was like, I feel like deja vu. It's almost like we've seen this before somewhere. Maybe every game. But to be fair for this game, relatively low kills, so there hasn't been too much action going on. But a couple of things are pretty ridiculous. One, we've got Quicksilver Sash completed for Oh Mother Hen. You're like, but Rapid, why is there a Quicksilver Sash on Oh Mother Hen? I'll tell you, it's for Subjugate. So basically, for Turb, he's going to ult Oh Mother Hen to steal all those defensive stats. You can QSS that Subjugate off, and all of a sudden Trundle instantly like loses. So here's what happens. Trundle doesn't lose the bonus stats, but it removes the debuff from Malphite, so he won't have his bonus stats stolen.
So then they're just both big tanks like running into each other exactly. Like 6 seconds.
But the idea is that theoretically the damage should be low enough on RMU so that if Oh Mother Hen doesn't have his stats stolen, he'll be pretty ridiculously effective. So that's what we're looking for. Just a little bit interesting. I was like, oh, there's a Quicksilver Sash.
I actually really like that. It's impressive. Hold on, Psynotic being caught out here. Nice. Dragon in two. Oh, actually over his ultimate there from Psynotic, but Jesse actually might be in a bad position here. He gets exhausted. He does get the kill onto the onto Psynotic, the support for RMU, but Mikey Moss able to kite around and pick up that kill. So nice shutdown going over to Robert Morris University, but it looks like Carlton maybe finally picking up and evening up the turrets here.
Good for maybe both not. Teams. Whoa, big barrel! Look at that!
Huge explosive cast coming out, but Nubsy's not able to pick up a kill here. Ecstasy still alive. Musical Notes has a flash out, and now Banana Warrior popped his ultimate. He keeps everyone safe as well. So play after play from both sides. Able to keep both of them safe, or I guess nothing really happens. I don't know. I don't know. It depends on what perspective you're coming from here, but that might expose Carlton's inner mid lane turret as Ecstasy and Musical Notes both have to go back.
Really interesting to see Omother Hen ditch the mid lane, head down to the bottom half of the map. Omother Hen's got a Malphite ult. Like, you just run up there, ult everyone, that's turnaround potential. Unfortunately, he was not with the team this time, and we've seen both solo laners, or both side laners, really have some team fights that they're just not a part of where their team could definitely use them. For instance, when Freakin' Poke goes in with that big, incredible explosive cask play, all you gotta have is a Malphite ult to just ult the backline during that, and you're pretty good. Ecstasy, luckiest man alive there, flashed out immediately afterwards and actually managed to survive there. Unfortunately, that is an Ash Flash, and it's very, very valuable. So now that it's gone, it's gonna be very vulnerable considering that that explosive cask is actually almost off cooldown, and Freakin' Poke can just do that again, and there's no counterplay options for Ash.
Oh, Musical Notes, very nice wind wall, once again disrupting the Tectonic Disruption. Very nicely played. Musical Notes knowing what he's doing with those wind walls, so making that Yasuo count pick. So let's talk about itemization here for one moment, because I just noticed Turb, he's finally building a little bit of armor, I'm guessing going into the Iceborne Gauntlet, but started with his Spirit Visage, and you know, that does synergize really well with his passive, but he's going up against a lot of AD in Musical Notes and Ecstasy. What do you think of that one?
Well, for Musical Notes, I think the biggest thing that you want to watch out for is allowing him to get those big AoE knockoffs off. If he does, then it becomes kind of a twofold idea. You either want to peel him off immediately or focus him down and kill him. Big arrow misses barely.
Carlton not being able to pull the trigger on their team comp, because that would have been almost perfect. Oh, Mother Hen even uses teleport to get up there. So, man. Yeah, it's not going so well for Carlton. Like I said, they have an idea. They have a great idea for a team comp. It's just not being executed. RMU, they're capitalizing on this one with objectives. They got five turrets now. Dragon's going to be up in 10 seconds as well.
Watching Trundle kind of club his way through the top lane. See two Titanic Hydras this game. In the most recent patch, you can now no longer trade your Titanic Hydra in for a Ravenous Hydra, but I don't think either one of these champions would build that. That's primarily something you saw on Fiora. But here we go, Dragon number three for RMU. Dragon number two, as it was not stolen away. We'll go over here to Carlton. Ash, you got to give up that Scuttlecrab. Can't walk into Braum right there, but I tell you what can walk into Braum's an entire team.
Oh, yeah, that was Last Breath also used. Ecstasy picking up that kill from the volley on the back line. But there, nice flash from Nubsy dodging out the unstoppable force.
Oh my gosh.
Half health there by the Nubsy Tectonic Disruption combo.
Diving over the wall. Jesse's
by himself.
I don't know, man. Explosive cask.
Well,
not explosive cast, but barrel roll. A couple of interesting things about barrel roll. Not only has it just been buffed, life orb disintegration ray.
Oh, Mother Hen, are you going to go down? And flash from Freakin' Pope, going to be able to take him down, but that also takes Freakin' Pope's life with him. Jesse picking up that kill. Meanwhile, Turb in the top lane. Let's talk about this. He just took an inhibitor.
Oh, by the way, he took a Nexus turret. He's actually winning the game this entire time, so my boy Turb, put it in turbo mode.
Gosh.
He is having the time of his life. Plus, he also still has Subjugate too, so he's pretty much unkillable. He can also rejoin Mikey Moss down there, and just kind of takes a tour de force, runs all the way top lane, through an base turret, through an inhibitor, through a Nexus turret, and then runs out the other side of the base, man.
Yeah, big misplay from Carlton, not realizing that Turb has just been split pushing this entire time, and he still has teleport. He can just do that again
exactly
in the bot lane if he wants to.
And there's a ward he can teleport to that's very close to the enemy base as well, so definitely something to keep an eye on. You might say that after that entire, you know, having their base destroyed like that, that Carlton are possibly angry, nigh perturbed.
I was actually thinking that in my head as you were saying. I was like, I wonder if he's going to do this. If not, I'm going to.
Too fast. Oh my gosh.
Yeah, no, that was good. You're on turbo mode that one, that on those puns there. Anyway.
All right, time for Baron.
Yeah.
Let's take the attention off of my terrible puns and see if we can see Jesse get caught out here. Of course, Jesse's like, man, you're not in here. I'm not in here with you. You're in here with me. Horses in the back away. There's the Brommel. Used a little bit prematurely.
Nice glacial. Yeah, nice glacial fissure. Yeah, did disengage Carlton. We still have yet to really full-on team fight. I have yet to see them land their comp. And once they do, I think it'll hurt. But I just don't know because you can't really go off of speculation. Sometimes it's really nice just to see. We haven't seen it yet. Musical notes. He's going to that bot lane inhibitor turret. Does not want to give up another one. Turb just staying in that bot lane area. And RMU, they're starting up the Baron. I hope this is going to be all right for them. Turb, he's still pressuring that bot lane, keeping musical notes at bay right now. And it looks like RMU decided to break off of the Baron.
There's another QSS being built, this time by Musical Notes, and that's a little bit wacky. It's, I would imagine, mostly for Braum's stun, or slow, maybe explosive cask slow, but... Oh man, big arrow only hits onto Sonotic, but even with Unbreakable, he might be able to get broken.
Oh, there's the Unstoppable Force I was looking for, but there is no Musical Note followed up, and now RMU, they are countering back.
Oh,
double
my
kill for
God.
Mikey Moss. Huge, huge disintegration ray from Nubsy, and Mikey Moss taking full advantage of the damage being thrown down, picking up a triple kill. Turb, he's now going to meet up with Jezzy and Musical Note. Nobody can take up both of their damages here. And with that bot lane inhibitor turret almost down, it looks like RMU may be looking to focus onto that. Or just go straight to the Nexus.
Yeah, Jesse actually has to flash onto the summoner platform. And hey man, one big fight's all it takes. The Nexus explodes. And that's RMU taking game number one, 10-6 over Carlton.
Yeah, it is a best of three. We'll see if Carlton, they had a great idea going into Champion Select. I don't feel like they had a bad Champion Select whatsoever. They just did not execute their game plan. They had, like I said earlier, they had a loaded gun. They did not pull the trigger. It was on safety the entire time. So we'll see if they can pull that one through next go around.
Yeah, well, while they look to get their head in the game, we are going to take a quick commercial break. So don't go anywhere. Stick around. We'll have game number two of RMU versus Carlton coming your way when we return.